Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today we are going to discuss about United Introduction, Low Bears Weight, Bears Asphyxia, Bears Injury, RDS. First of all, we have to know the meaning of neonate. Neonate is for any baby born from bears up to 4 weeks of age. The term baby, any baby delivered after 37 weeks of pregnancy up to 41 weeks. Preterm baby, any baby less than 37 weeks. Postterm baby are babies who are born after 42 weeks of or more. The normal birth weight is 2.5 kilo to 4 kilo. Macrosomia means a child or a neonate whose weight is more than 4 kilos. Sometimes we are going to find a baby who has been, his weight is macrosomic. We also call him large for gestational age. This means his birth weight is more than the 90th centile. The low birth weight are babies whose weight are less than 2.5 kilos. This is a picture or a photo for a macrosomic baby whose weight is more than 4 kilos. That is low birth weight, and this is also something called very low birth weight for any newborn whose weight is less than 1.5 to 1 kilo. Extreme low birth weight for any newborn whose weight is less than 1 kilo. Small for gestational age are those whose weight are less than 2 standard deviation of the mean. This is low birth weight. This means his weight is less than 2.5. This is a very low birth weight, means his weight is 1.5 to 1 kilos. This is extreme low birth weight, whose weight is less than 1 kilo. This is also extreme low birth weight, his weight is less than 1 kilo. What are the causes of low birth weight? Or IUGR, we can sometimes call them IUGR. It can be one of the three causes, either maternal causes or fetal causes or placental disease. Those IUGR or low birth weight are at risk for hypoxia and disease. He also has been prone for hypothermia, polycythemia, hypocalcemia, and hypoglycemia. After deliveries, we are always assess the newborn by something called Apgar score. Apgar score is a score is out of 10. It has got 5 tests we have to do. Each test is either 0, 1, or 2. The first is the appearance. The second is pulse. The third is crimis. The fourth is activity. And the fourth is respiration. The baby is supposed to have at least 8 out of 10 to mention that he is normal. If it is less than 7, means we have to do something for the baby to get the 8 out of 10 in his score. Now we can start problems. Usually we can get a problem like that. A female newborn delivered at term to gravid 3 mother by lower segment cesarean section after failure of forceps. Delivery due to fetal distress. The baby didn't cry after delivery and Apgar score was 1 at 1 minute, 4 at 5 minutes, 7 at 10 minutes, and 8 at 15 minutes. As we said, if you get at 8, it is good. But this 8, we should get it at least after 5 minutes and not at 15 or 10 minutes. If 8, he get this 8 after 5 minutes, means he has got some problems in his breathing or for asphyxia. So, the baby was admitted in ICU. They noticed to be irritable with high-pitched cry, mottled skin, and later developed generalized convulsion. What is the possible diagnosis? What investigation we are supposed to do? And what would be your management? This is a typical case of bear's asphyxia. So asphyxia means, asphyxia is a very important cause for brain damage. Asphyxia means suffocation or reduce oxygen delivery to all tissue of the body, mainly to the brain. You can assess asphyxia antenatally by a fetal CTG, or we can assess it by a cord blood gas or by doing Apgar score after delivery. If the baby has been prone for asphyxia, the sequel of asphyxia is hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. So hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy is the term used to describe the clinical manifestation of brain injury immediately or 24 hours after delivery. What are the symptoms and signs of asphyxia? The main sign, the baby is going to be irritable or lethargic. If you are going to start feed, he's not going to feed. He is going to feed, he will be impaired. He will have a very high pitched cry. He will have a mottled skin and will have a staring look, convulsion, or abnormal movements of both upper and lower limbs. And there will be no spontaneous movement, or there will be a minor response to pain. His tone is going to be increased or decreased, and will get also hypotension. This is a child who has been prone to asphyxia, means difficult and decreased oxygen to the brain and to all body, and he has got abnormal posture. We can see he has got arching of the back, hyperextended of the neck, and extended of both upper and lower limb. If you have got a patient with asphyxia, we can investigate him by doing CBC as a routine. We are going to do urine, electrolyte, and calcium, magnesium, liver function tests, CBK, and LDH, because all these will be affected by decreased oxygen supply to the tissue. Also, we are going to do arterial blood gas, skeletal survey, because if it has been asphyxia, maybe has got some injury, and we can do CT scan or ultrasound brain. How we are going to treat asphyxia? Treatment is supportive and symptomatic. This means if he has got some respiratory problems, we have to support respiration and circulation, and we have to make sure that he has got a patent airway and his breathing is normal, and we have to insert an IV cannula for giving medication and fluids. If he has got convulsion, we have to treat the convulsion by giving phenobarbital, phenytoin, midazolam infusion. We are going to make fluid restriction, and we are going to treat his electrolyte imbalance, because it's going to affect his potassium and his calcium and his sodium. And if he has got hypotension, we can treat hypotension by giving a volume expander or by giving inotropes. Also, we are going to treat, he has got increased intracranial pressure, we are going to treat the intracranial pressure. We are going for our next problem. This is 30 years old, multigravid mother with history of diabetes for 5 years. She is on insulin treatment. She delivered a male term child, 4.8. This means she's macrosomic by vaginal route with difficulty and with shoulder dystocia. The Apgar score was 3 at 1 and 8 at 5. Which are normal. They notice that he has got a large swelling in the right parietal region, and the baby he was unable to move his left shoulder and keeping the left upper limb in pronation, extension, of the elbow. What is the diagnosis and what investigation we are going to do and how we are going to treat? Now we can discuss about burst injury. The causes of burst injury due to malposition of the baby inside the uterus, or maybe he's a large size baby, or due to maneuvers from forceps or ventosa or for other things. The injury can be in the soft tissue, and this will lead to cubus succedaneum, or it can lead to kephale hematoma, or it can lead to jugnon, or bruising, or abrasion, or it can lead to subapneuritic hemorrhage. You can see in this slide, you have got swelling at the head, and this is a kephale hematoma. This is also kephale hematoma. Also again, kephale hematoma. Here we can see the blade of the forceps over his forehead and over the nose with abrasions. Here also we can see abrasion and contusion over the right cheek and the right eye. So brain injury, as we mentioned, can be in the soft tissue, it can be in the peripheral nerve, and it can affect the upper nerve root, upper brachial plexus, as C5 and C6, result in air palsy. Or it can affect the lower root, as C8, T1, resulting in Columbic palsy. It can affect also the cranial nerve, it can lead to fracture of the humerus, fracture of the clavicle, fracture of the femur, or you can injure the internal organ. This is a picture for a macrosomic child. The child, his left hand is flexed, which is normal. The left upper limb is flexed at the elbow, which is a normal posture and position. But the right upper limbs are extended and pronated and not flexed, and this is right air palsy. Here the same macrosomic child, the right upper limbs are flexed at the elbow, is flexed at the elbow, but the left is extended, pronated, and cannot raise it. And that is left air palsy. And this is the same with the right air palsy. This is a child who has got a cranial nerve injury at the facial nerve, leading to deviation of the mouse. This is a slice showing fracture of the left femur. So how we are going to diagnose burst injuries? By clinical diagnosis, to see, to take the history, what happened, and you know. And then we are going to examine the baby to see if have got fracture or swelling or abnormal movements or inability to move any limbs. And we can do x-ray to exclude fracture. We can do CT scan or ultrasound to see if there is internal organ injury, and we can do CBC. The treatment will be according to the cause. For air palsy, we are going for many of them like air palsy assurance and assurance or conservative. If not, we can do physiotherapy. For fracture, we can do blasters. The third problem is a primary gravid mother delivered at 30 weeks of pregnancy, a male child 1.2 with upgrade score of 5 at 1, 8 at 5, developed granting cyanosis, tachypnea, chest retraction at 4 hours of life. On examination, he was ill, mottled skin, bilateral crepitation with chest X-ratio, ground glass appearance. So, what's the diagnosis and how you are going to treat? This is a typical case of respiratory distress syndrome, or can cause hyaline membrane disease, which is due to deficiency of surfactant. The surfactant is a lipoprotein excreted by type 2 or type B cell that lower the surface tension of the alveoli. Why the baby is going to get an RDS? The risk factors are prematurity, if the mother has got history of diabetes, if the baby has been delivered by cesarean section, or he has got asphyxia. The more preterm, the more RDS. That is why if a mother with a premature pain, we are going to give her glucocorticoids 24 hours before delivery. This will lead symptoms of RDS occurring during the first few hours after delivery. The sign of RDS are tachypnea, chest retraction, expiratory grunting, and cyanosis. The most important thing is the X-ray finding in RDS, which show a ground glass appearance or reticulogranular appearance with air bronchogram. How we are going to diagnose? We'll diagnose by the clinical picture, which with the presentation, which had been grunting, cyanosis, and dyspnea and tachypnea, and we are going to confirm by the X-ray chest. If we have got a new need with respiratory distress, we have to make a differential diagnosis of something called transient tachypnea of the new need, or maybe has got a congenital pneumonia, or he has got congenital lung anomaly, or he has got congenital heart disease. The investigation for RDS is X-ray chest, arterial blood gas, blood culture, ECG, and echocardiogram. This is an X-ray chest of a child who has got RDS. The treatment. The treatment for RDS, if you have got a patient who has got an RDS, we are going to keep him inside the incubator with minimal handling because he's most likely a preterm. We have to support his ventilator or his respiratory support and circulatory support. We can give him exogenous surfactant therapy, and we can give him nothing per oral. We give him IV fluids, electrolyte support, antibiotic, and inotropes. Thank you.